The fall of Mubarak, there was a debate in Israel. Why we cannot have such a movement here? And it's interesting that they asked this question, because we didn't have Mubarak. We didn't have a... No one thought that Netanyahu is a dictator or something like this. But they wanted to be part of this democratization in the Middle East. The first signs of this kind of mobilization started immediately after, with some movements organized in Facebook. Started a movement against raising the price of gas, and they succeeded. Another movement against raising the price of cottage. The cheese, cottages, and they succeeded. And then started the J-14 movement, inspired by the Egyptian experience, and it started from an encampment of 10 tents in the Rothschild Boulevard. But it was clear that it was related to Egypt. The you see here the tents, and the name in Hebrew is Rothschild Corner Tahrir. And this was the idea. We are part of something that is already in move. The incredible impact of this 10 tents, I think it's completely without precedent in Israel. Completely without any precedent in Israel. They succeeded to mobilize in a few days more and more people in Rothschild Boulevard, but in all over the country, in new encampments. And the first demonstration, I think it was 10 days after that, with 40,000 people in Tel Aviv. And the mobilization, there was an expectation that every week will be another demonstration. It started from one demonstration in Tel Aviv, but it expanded to demonstrations all over the country every Saturday night. There was a joke of my friend that his son, one Saturday night, that there was no demonstration, he asked, what happened? It was a kind of enthusiasm that we can go together to the streets and struggle. But the interesting point is that the different groups joined with different agendas. It wasn't only... The first demand of the group was related to housing, to the price of rents and buying houses, and a demand from the government to subsidize renting houses. This was the very beginning. And later, the agenda started to expand to every sphere, education, health, the price of kindergartens. There was a movement of of parents with their children. They were demonstrating there. Trade unions joined. At the beginning, specific trade unions that were in struggle, like the doctors, but later on, the Istadrut itself, the big trade union, the student organization, the national student organization joined the movement, and the media. I think we could say the media joined the movement. The media completely covered everything they did, every day, all the demonstrations, with a very sympathizing attitude. And the popular support in the polls was 85% of the population. They were the main cry was the people want social justice. I'm sorry that we don't have the Egyptian movie because it was exactly in the same the same music and the same tempo. It was the people want. Okay, I will not sing this song. But it became so popular that everyone was using this slogan to sell everything you want. The very fact that they started to talk about the people, they are talking in the name. The people in the case of Israel is what we call here the 99%. It's very clear. It's the same idea. We are the people. But they started to talk about the new Israeli, a new identity for the Israelis, based on solidarity and not in the individualism of the market. They were demanding a welfare state. This was also one of the slogans. It's coming, it's coming, the welfare state is coming. The government was forced to react. They couldn't ignore it. The support was so broad that almost in every party were people talking, defending the demonstrations and supporting them. And they formed a committee, a special committee to change the policies of the government in order to overcome the inequality in Israel. Completely the different, the opposite of the policy that Netanyahu was doing for the last 15 years. And the committee suggested that their recommendations were strong changes in the policy. Instead of reducing taxes to have higher taxes for the higher for the richer, also reducing the security budget, and the government already decided to do it. The movement said it's not sufficient; they want more. But I think it's already an achievement. But it's not. This is only the beginning, and they say this is only the beginning. And the question is, where are we going to? The climax was in the in September 3rd. This was called the 1 million march. This is only Tel Aviv. It was all over the country, in different places. I don't know if you can see, the streets entering also were full, and square is the square of the state. It's not the famous Rabin Square. It's the biggest square in Israel. No one did have the courage to go to this square to make a demonstration. It was completely full before the demonstration. The newspapers argued that it, in order to make full this the square, they need 500,000. In my opinion, there was 500,000, but the police said that there were only 300,000. So the movement, they didn't debate if there were 500,000 or not. It's a peanut. But in Jerusalem, you have 60,000. In Haifa, two, and there were, I think, 14 different places where these demonstrations took place all over the country. Something important, September 3. Why September 3? They knew in advance, September is a month that you cannot demonstrate for social or economic issues. September was the from the beginning, from the since the Palestinian movement decided to apply to the United Nations to recognize the Palestinian state, it was clear that September it will be a month that all the media will be concerned with the Palestinians. So from the beginning they said September 3 will be the 1 million march. When they started in July 14, they said this will be the... So it was clear that they were aware of the fact that there are spaces in time to organize these kinds, and there are spaces that you cannot do nothing. So let's start. What I want to do, like questions I want to try to answer is, why they are taking Tahrir as a model? Is this a democratization process? Is Israel a democracy or isn't? Why are they ignoring injustice suffered by Palestinians and their non-democratic situation? If they are claiming justice inside Israel, why not for the Palestinians too? Is there a chance that the July 14 movement will radically transform the Israeli polity? In order to answer these questions, I will use the framework of the theory I developed in my book, Politics and Violence in Israel-Palestine, and also parts of the analysis of what happened in the last 20 years in politics. And I will. I decided to use this PowerPoint in order to rush, because otherwise, if I start talking about the movement, I will not make the point, the more theoretical and macro-historical point that I want to make, where we are now and what can we expect for the future. So the concept I use is a political space. Political space is a critical tool to analyze democratic regimes. The concept is designed to uncover rules of the game, institutions, discourses, practices, and political actors that close political space to subordinated groups in processes of democratization and in well-established democratic regimes. This is the idea. This is a critical concept. It's not only to assume that the democracy is working. Sometimes the democracy is closing the space for subordinated groups. The political space is symbolic space of recognition and representation of dominated groups, mediation and compromise within the framework of the state. Political spaces can be opened when there are recognized borders and a balance of power relations. This is a very crucial point. These are the fundamentals of political space. When there are recognized borders, the borders define who are the people. When you say we the people, and in the context of the United States it's very funny, the we the people, who are the people then? You define. But when you have borders also, when you have these borders, symbolic and physical borders, you can claim that you are equal. It's not that you are equal, but you can make the point and claim and mobilize. And the balance of power is crucial, because everyone that can rule without recognizing the other does it. So the dominated groups need some power to balance the power of the dominant. The opening occurs when dominated groups effectively resist power by civil society mobilization and political articulation, and the rulers have no option but recognize the legitimate claims. In some moment, this is a classic process of democratization, all the theories of democratization, the rulers in some moment recognize that they cannot continue repression. When dominant groups can rule by violence, they use it and close the space. Violence is the best way to close political spaces. Here we start to arrive to Israel. Settler societies have a problem with democracy. because settler societies want democracy for themselves, but not for the local populations, and not also for Africans that they bring. They want what has been called herrenvolk democracy. This is the democracy for the civilized peoples. It happened in North America, it happened in South Africa, in Australia and Israel, but the peculiarity of Israel is the only case that still don't recognize the local population. I don't want to demonize Israel. The case of the United States is much worse because they killed. In this sense, the fact that the Palestinians are still there and present, part of them are present, not all of them, this is something that is also peculiar. But, and you can explain, and we can explain why is this different. The problem is that this conflict is still there. The Israeli regime, when you do that, I think you're making some sign of time. don't make it. I have still, until I arrive to the movement, you see, we just arrived to Palestine. The success of Israel is to divide and rule the Palestinians by force, but it maintains its democratic image and rules of the game. This is the peculiarity that still allows the U.S. government to save the Palestinians, negotiate. They assume this is a democratic government, so you need to negotiate. According to my analysis, no chance that such negotiations can lead anyway, because there is no balance of power, and there are no borders. So, what was created since 67 is what I call a dual regime that is military democratic. The dual regime is a democracy for the Israeli Jews and a peculiar divide and rule regime for the Palestinian Arabs. The Palestinian Arabs are divided in mainly three groups, but it's more. You have the citizens of Israel, the second class citizens of Israel, and the occupied population. It must be clear, the border of Israel, the so-called border of Israel, the green line before 67, is a border that exists mainly to separate the A from B. This border, it doesn't make any difference for an Israeli Jew. It makes a difference if you are a Palestinian. Because if you are a second class, you are inside the border, and if you are occupied under the military, this is the West Bank and Gaza. But for sure, the occupied territories are divided between Gaza, that is very difficult situation and compared to the West Bank, and the better situation for the occupied population is in East Jerusalem. So they are also divided. And for sure, you have the refugees that are outside. The military democratic regime closes the political space to the Israelis too. And this is, in my opinion, the most important point to understand. By dividing the workers, you have workers, Palestinian workers without rights and Israeli workers with rights, and also in periods of violence. When you have violence, no political space for nothing inside Israel too. How it was... All this regime must have some legitimacy inside Israel. It was legitimized by a cartel of two tribal identities. Why cartel? Because it was a monopole until 77 of the left, so-called left, and it became a cartel of right-left when the tribal identities is a form to close political space. What is a tribal identity? Think about the United States too. You have two groups that hate each other, like a tribe, and mainly they hate the leader of the tribe, the tribe of the other, the chief. And there is no space to discuss nothing, because everything is mobilized through the identity. And there is no space, for example, to be in the middle, or to be in the left of the left, or to be in the right of the right. You have two tribes that close completely the political space. I was thinking about the United States. You cannot have a party on the left of the Democratic Party. But imagine you can. And you can have also the Tea Party also have their representation. It changes everything. It opens everything. So this dualism is crucial to close political spaces. And the cartel succeeded to mobilize, to manipulate, and also to cover all the conflicts inside Israel. Class conflicts were there, ethnic conflicts were there, religious, secular conflicts. All these hostilities became left and right. But they are covered because you cannot discuss none of these issues, and you cannot represent none of these issues. Okay, the democratic opening starts with Intifada. Today, the first Intifada, because we have a second. It put an end to the stability of the regime. It demarcated the borders of the state of Israel and also the hopeful state of Palestine, and created new power relations, forcing Israel to recognize the Palestinians and to negotiate. The elections in 1992 coordinated the two arenas claiming the change of priority order. I want to explain this point. We have two arenas of politics. As a matter of fact, we have three, but now I want to talk about two. The internal arena of the politics inside Israel, with conflicts and different identities and claims, etc. And we have the Israeli-Palestinian arena of relations that also need to be democratized. The question is how to do it. So the articulation was done by the leader, and later, for sure, by the cooperation with the leader of the Palestinians. It was Rabin, and Rabin articulated the two arenas with the slogan changing the order of priorities. What does it mean? We need to stop investing money, efforts, people in the occupied territories, and to put all this money inside Israel to develop the economy, to close the inequalities, etc., etc. That was the way that the Labour Party started the democratization process. From the moment the Palestinian space was open to negotiations, internal spaces within Israel were open too. Class conflicts appeared, ethnic hostility between Mizrahi and Ashkenazi Jews appeared, civil rights claims of the Palestinians inside Israel appeared, and the hostility between the secular and the religious. Everything was open. When you open one, you immediately open the other. When you close one, you close the other. That is my point. The tribal left-right mobilization was weakened by the emergence of the tensions between different sectors, because suddenly you have Mizrahi voices and that they can represent themselves. They don't need the Likud to do it. Also, the Ashkenazis with the anti-religious identities have their own parties. They don't need the Labour Party precisely. And they lost power. They lost. They were at the beginning of the process. They have more or less 80 seats in the Knesset. At the end of this process, they have 40 in 6 years, something like this. The dominant upper classes were unable and unwilling to open space to the peripheral groups, which were mobilized one against the other, creating fear of national disintegration. The point is the following. It's not only to recognize the identity of the Mizrahis or the Arab Palestinian citizens or, or the Orthodox is also to put money on the in the budget to solve to solve their problems. So the dominant group that was mainly motivated to keep power on their hands was completely unable to open the political space to the other groups. Unable and willing, because it was it meant to share their power. And this was the failure. This is my argument in my book. The failure of the peace process, it was mainly inside Israel, not in the relations with the Palestinians, because as a matter of fact, they didn't enter even negotiations, real negotiations. But the process failed due to the inability to coordinate the opening of political spaces in the two arenas. Rabin assassination is the turning point of the process. What we have since then is more or less what they could call chaos. The Palestinian authorities are inside the territories. The military is are surrounding them and separating them, but they have some standing, some organization, and there is no possibility of stability in this situation, because Rabin was killed in the movement. We don't know where he was moving at all. You can imagine what was. But the process was ended in the middle without any possibility to continue, and not without the political forces and without the agendas to continue this movement. The Israeli internal tensions grew until 2000, and the feeling was that Israeliness was disappearing to sector, and sectoral identity started to appear, and completely ignoring the suffering of the Palestinians. I call this the imagined peace. We imagined what that we were in a peace process. Then immediately the internal struggles appeared, but no one was taking in consideration that Palestinians are in a worse situation than before. Then when the second intifada appeared, the Israelis united against the Palestinians. So all the previous tensions went again under the carpet, were covered by the violence, but also all the openings inside Israel were closed. Violence closed the space for the Palestinian representation and the space for the Israeli representation. And now I come to the what I call the orphan generation, or Dorbet. Dor is in Hebrew a generation, and B is Bet is the name of the movement. The movement was called Bet is the first letter of Bait, home. And this is the way they call themselves. And I added that the meaning of Dorbet is also related to labor relations, because Dorbet was something that was invented to worsen the situation of the next generation of workers. It was invented by the trade unions. When there were struggles, they said, okay, we can compromise with you, but the next workers will not have your conditions. And this is Dorbet. This is the meaning, the next generation. It means that parents, not direct parents, I didn't do that to my daughter and my son, but in principle, I have better conditions than them. Work conditions, salaries, and pension rights, whatever, my generation has much better than the next generation. And this is something new, because in the past it was the opposite. We have better situation than our parents. This generation has a very interesting history and experience. The experience, I think more or less I could locate this generation starting with Daphne Leaf. Daphne Leaf is the first leader of the movement. She's a girl, she's now 25. And she was 10 when Rabin was killed, or 9. And she tells the story when in the demonstrations on the media. This is the first experience, the loss of hope when Rabin was assassinated. And the feel is all the violent experiences of the Second Intifada, the repression, terror, and the neoliberal economics. This is the experience of this generation. I think we can frame them as being 10 to 20 in the day that Rabin was assassinated. That is tomorrow, by the way, November 4th. The neoliberal economics also forced them to start to struggle. I think almost immediately, because the meaning was that the middle classes were losing their economic power and their resources, and the children felt it too, for sure. I witnessed in the university by the strikes of the students. The first strike was in 1998, and already in that strike I said, this is a generation that wants their own political space, and they are building something new. This was a very impressive strike during 50 days. All the universities and colleges in Israel were closed, and the constant demonstrations. And they even then started to develop the discourse that solved the problem of identities, of sectorialism. That this was the problem of the left leading to peace, that they didn't want to include the others. And they started in their slogans were, we are Jews and Arabs, Mizrahi and Ashkenazi, women and men, periphery and the center. These were the slogans in 1998. And at the end of the struggle, a group of them went to a hunger struggle that lasted 20 days. Bibi Netanyahu was the prime minister, and he broke the struggle in a very nasty way. I don't want to enter the story, but it's the story of the pizza, famous story of the pizza. He brought the pizza to the strikers, and some were eating, but there were people that were not in the hunger strike. But then the media took their pictures, and it broke all the solidarity of the movement. Incredible. He's now, in my opinion, paying the bill of his irresponsibility on those days. In 2007, there was another strike of students again. Their claim is not against a rise of fees like here. It was to reduce the fees. They claim to reduce it in 50%. But there were other strikes. And this is very interesting. In the last years, the high school teachers went to strike. The doctors are now, I think they are still, they didn't solve the conflict. They are striking for 5 months by now. And the social workers. In each of these cases, there was a conflict inside the trade union between the new generation and the old generation. The new generation were the representatives of the trade union, and they are in power, and they always compromise, and they didn't improve the situation of the young generation. And they, in several cases, they broke the agreement. After the trade union reached an agreement, the young people went against the agreement. Now this is the problem in the case of the doctors. They resigned from their jobs in the hospitals. Not only strike, they resigned from their jobs in the hospital. They don't accept the compromise with the government. This generation started to organize NGOs. They worked with Oriental Jews and with Rajans and with youth and women, Arabs and Bedouins in peripheral towns. They also organized, these are the socio-economic organizations, and there are a lot of organizations struggling against the occupation. I don't want to mention in order not to offend a group, but I must. You have a Maxim Watch, and you have a Tayush, and you have the soldiers refusing to go to the soldiers that go to the military, but they afterwards they tell what they are doing. The coalition, Women Coalition for Peace, the Women in Black, whatever, a lot of organizations. And now Sheikh Jarrah, and now Sheikh Jarrah, I think they call themselves now Solidarity. I want to make clear, in the J-14, these two groups of social and economic activists and peace activists are together. They are participating together. And what you have now is a kind of atmosphere of democratization. In the tents, you don't have only discussions about the neoliberal economy and how to reduce inequality. And so there were debates also on the one-state solution. So everything is open and everything is legitimate. This is what the movement is trying to do. There is a very important organization that I must mention is Koach Laobdim, the organization of the workers that are not organized by the Istadrut. And this is a very important organization. They have several achievements. The last one was yesterday night, I think, the agreement in Haifa of Kimikali. They are fighting all the time to organize the unorganized. And the case of yesterday, it was precisely canceling the Dorbe, the agreement that allowed to separate the young from the veterans. This was the meaning of the last agreement. They are doing a very important work in creating the atmosphere of solidarity. The movement is very interesting in the sense that they have assemblies every day that you have also now in this Occupy movement. I hate the word Occupy. End the occupation, that is the idea. So why Occupy? But they have these assemblies every day in the tents. They have also big meetings, national meetings, because it's not coming from New York and San Francisco. It's coming from Haifa and Jerusalem. So they have national meetings. So there is an atmosphere of democracy, but there are people taking decisions. It's not only, you know, everyone can do everything. For example, the decision to go to the this demonstration or other demonstration is central. So they are doing something that, in my opinion, is very interesting, clever, and intelligent. The question is, can the J-14 movement open political space in both arenas? Not only inside Israel, but also for the Palestinians. Well, my argument is that they have no choice. If they don't open the political space to recognize and negotiate with the Palestinians, their own space will be closed by violent clashes with external enemies. And you can trust Netanyahu, he will find external enemies everywhere. No problem if at the beginning it was Abu Mazen, Fatah. Now Fatah is Israel, then Hamas, and now Jihad is Islam, and now Iran. And you can continue. Our problem is that the United States supports him. That is the real tragedy. So they have no choice but change. So are they doing something in this direction? There are some elements of democratization already from the beginning. If we need balance of power, they are trying to balance the power of what you call here 1%, they call it the tycoons. The tycoons are not 1%, and the 1% of the percent of the percent is a very, very small group. And they are talking in the name of the people, that is almost everyone. It's the middle classes, the lower classes, the upper middle classes. But the interesting point is that it's not only that they are balancing the power of the tycoons, they are unintentionally demarcating the borders of the state because they are claiming houses in their cities, not in the occupied territories. They don't say that. I think they even didn't think about it. But the government is building houses all the time in the occupied territories, is investing a lot of money building houses. So if you are in the settlement, you cannot join the movement except if you go to Tel Aviv to join the movement. But if you go to Tel Aviv to join the movement, it's okay. This is exactly what they want. Go back to the borders of Israel. But they cannot make an encampment in the territories and claim, build for us houses, because the government is building houses for them. So unintentionally, by starting from the question of housing, they demarcated the borders of Israel. So you have people demonstrating everywhere, but these are the borders within Israel. And it was funny because the settlers at the beginning immediately reacted by attacking the movement as leftists. Also they said, if you want houses, cheap houses, you can come to the territories. No problem. And when they saw that it's so popular, they started to try to join the club. Even Kahana had some tents in Rothschild. So they wanted to be part of the, because this, if this is a people, they want to be part of the people. But they failed, completely failed. And I think the most important is to create the feeling that there is space for everyone in the movement. Because part of the failure of the left, the Ashkenazi left, it was identified with the upper middle classes, with the secular identity. And my impression is that they are aware that they want to escape this image. At the beginning, it was the main campaign to say these are spoiled kids. They are eating sushi and And they are aware that the demands must include the demands of the lower classes, that these are the ethnic groups that are excluded. It's not at all easy to do. But this is a point that they are working hard to build this coalition. And it's related to the demands of social justice, the better housing, education, and health. I know the ages of the generation because my young son is 25 and my daughter is 35. So this is exactly, she was 20 and he was 10 when Rabin was killed. And my daughter is part of the Jerusalem camp. And you have several camps in Jerusalem. Part are of people that are really without house, that are in the streets. Families, mainly women with children, women alone, and they have some camps, separate camps, and they are doing now squat. But these squats are not squats to stay there. These are squats to demonstrate that they are without houses. And this became now a very strong event, because in order to remove them from their houses they are taking, they are using a lot of violence, and became also an important issue. How do they build a new discourse? That it's clear that it's connecting the question of the Palestinians with the question of... it's not at all easy. Because at the moment that they will be tagged as leftists, they lose the struggle. So they do it in a very mild way. They mentioned that Rabin assassination is the first experience they had. Rabin is always there. I think they even exaggerate a lot. At the end I will show you a show. I think it creates an atmosphere that we are yearning to Rabin, yes? It's a problematic, but mentioning the assassination of Rabin is a political point. It has a political meaning. They emphasize the building of a new Israeli identity based on solidarity and justice, and it is inclusive of the peripheral group, but it includes also the Palestinians. This is very important. I'm not sure that they are succeeding to do it in practical terms, and there are a lot of problems, because the Palestinians citizens are very suspicious of the movement. They say, well, at the end you will make us the doorbell. We will forget us. You will have houses for you, but not for us. And there are groups that are struggling for... Now, for example, there is a decision to destroy the houses of 30,000 Bedouins in the Negev. The movement is against that, but it's not mobilizing all the masses against that. So it's difficult to mobilize everyone in solidarity with the Bedouins. It's not easy, and this is exactly the kind of challenges the movement is facing. But obviously the most important obstacle is that the government can easily escalate violence and mobilize fear and hate, not against the movement. This is a mistake idea. Against the Arabs and against the Palestinians is sufficient. You don't need any more, nothing more to close the space for the economic and social claims. But because at the moment you have more fear and hate, it closes the space for the Palestinians, it closes the space for them. So they must continue, and it's not at all easy. They started, I think, to move in this way. I don't know if you know, the last Saturday there was a demonstration in Tel Aviv, big demonstration in Tel Aviv. I don't want to say how many people were, but I will show pictures. This is the first time they go to Rabin Square, where he was killed. And they made a big issue for the fact that they are in Rabin Square, and the Rabin Square was full. I will show you some pictures. But the important point, it was in the middle of the fire in Gaza. and in the there were demonstrations also in Jerusalem and Haifa, and the demonstration in Beersheba was cancelled because Beersheba was under fire. So this window of opportunity in the summer disappeared. September is over. Now they need to continue. And if they continue, they need to start being able to mobilize people also in periods of violence. I think this is also with no precedent. Such a big demonstration on socioeconomic issues. It wasn't on for peace. For peace, there were big demonstrations. But for socioeconomic issues in the time of fire on the south, it never happened. And who was in this stage? And this is where I can refer to the earning grabbing and how you can use it politically. They invited the most famous, one of the most famous satiric group that were 15 years ago, not by chance. And they made a sketch. They start to say, "Oh, we are in Rabin Square. Do you remember how nice it was in those days? Rabin was alive." And then they start to make a joke of the situation since then. Once they come and say hello. Hello in Hebrew is shalom. Don't say shalom. Don't say peace. You cannot say peace now. It's very subversive to say peace now. And they started to say, "Are we expecting now again? Do we have hope? Are you going to change?" And they say, no, this cannot be." They joke, "What is this smell?" And they start to say, "Well, we don't smell hope, we don't smell change. What you are smelling is war." The challenge is very difficult. The chances that the government will be able to reactivate violence and silence the movement are big. But this will push the movement to decision. They will need to decide how to react. It is a real movement, no doubt. The enthusiasm in the summer was incredible. Everyone wanted to be in the streets to be part of it. It means the political space of these people is closed for almost 15 years. So the enthusiasm that we can go to the street and make have a voice. This is a relation to Tahrir. In Tahrir also was a case to open the political space and to be recognized. This is a matter of recognition. I don't like to be optimistic or pessimistic, but I can show that this is a movement that it may reach the point of effective movement. And effective movements have two elements: civil society mobilization and political articulation. Still, there are no political parties, but they may appear. And I'm not talking about political parties, existing political parties, that are trying to make some capital from the movement, but really representing political parties of the movement. This may happen. I assume that if there is time, it will appear. But in part of the debate will be not only what are the socioeconomical claims, but also how to discuss the question of the peace with the Palestinians.